Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. All praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all. May He bless every one of us and our offspring, those to come up to the end. May Allah keep us steadfast, grant us all ease and goodness. My brothers and sisters in Islam, we as Muslims believe that we have been created and placed onto the earth as a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we were younger, perhaps we did not understand the meaning of that. But as you grow older and you witness the reality of life, and you begin to see people leave the earth, you see them die, and you see what their purpose was, and you see how short their lifespan actually was, you begin to understand the reality of this test. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed us in this beautiful place known as the earth, with an even more beautiful place awaiting us if we behave ourselves on earth. As simple as that. Now, when I say behave ourselves, it sounds like we are addressing children. But in essence, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are creatures. We are creatures Allah has favored to create better than the rest of the creatures. So in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. We have indeed created mankind in the best of postures. The best posture possible, you have it. And this, when Allah says something is the best, He's challenging you, because He doesn't lie. He's challenging you to say there is nothing better than the posture of man in creation that I have created. So if you take a look at your organs and exactly where they are placed and how they are made, your voice, the voice box, how you speak, Allah says it is absolutely the best. There is nothing you as a human being can think of to be better than your own posture, because this was heavenly. It was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I always tell people, can you imagine your nose in a different place? To this day, I have not got a single person saying, yes, I can imagine it. What are you going to say? At the back? Where? On your shoulder? Where? Where it is right now is the best place, subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي Adam. Indeed, the children of Adam, we have honored them. We have given them a dignity. There is a respect that they carry. Subhanallah. Look at how we are clothed. The clothing itself is a respect that a person has been given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a gift of Allah. And this is why if you want to be respected, you need to know how to cover yourself. The less you wear, those who believe would probably say, the less you will be respected. People begin to look at you as a sex object. You can say what you want, but they turn to look at you for the wrong reasons as a believer. They tend to value you based on what you've shown, not based on who exactly you are. Today I want to speak about something extremely important. This beautiful test, what does it entail? Allah made you, created you on the earth, and He has said, I have put you on this earth in order to test you. In order to test you. So when you come into the exam room or the school, what do you expect? You expect questions, situations. You need to answer them. You need to go into them. It will be an obstacle course that you need to come out from successful. So that's what life is. Every day you will have a test. Nobody from amongst us can say, I will not be tested. I have not been tested. I do not wish to be tested. When you have wealth, Allah will test you. When you don't have wealth, Allah will test you. When you have health, Allah will test you. When you don't have health, Allah will test you. It all depends on what you do. What you do in every situation that Allah puts you in. So, we have two major duties that we need to fulfill. What are these two duties? The first is the duty you have unto Allah, the one who made you. You have a duty unto Allah. يا أيها الإنسان ما غرك بربك الكريم الذي خلقك فسواك فعدلك. الله أكبر. Allah says, O man, what has deceived you? What is it that has deceived you against your own maker? How could you transgress against your own maker? Your Rabb, the one who is filled or full of honor, the one who is full of subhanallah mercy, the one who's full of all the greatest of qualities. How can you be deceived regarding this creator of yours? How can you turn away from your creator, the one who has made you, the one who has fashioned you, the one who has given you your identity? You know, the identity we have, who gave it to us? It was Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He chose, I know you by name. How do I know your name? Because I know your face. Soon as I see you from a distance, I know, oh, this is so and so. How? Allah's gift to be able to recognize you. Imagine if we all had the same face. We would need number plates. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. It's a gift of Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in an amazing, unique way, oh man, you have to worship me and me alone. That's the primary duty unto Allah. The first set of duties is your duty unto Allah. What is the main duty unto Allah? أن تعبدوه ولا تشركوا به شيئا. Hadith of Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asks him, O Mu'adh, do you know the duty of the creation towards Allah? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam responded to the same question that he was asking Mu'adh ibn Jabal. He says, to worship him without associating partners with him. That is your primary test on earth. It is one of the main things. In fact, it is the main thing that you are being tested with when you come onto the earth. So remember this, my beloved brothers and sisters. Your test is to worship Allah alone. Render acts of worship to Allah. In the meantime, when you came onto the earth, you came without anything. You were naked. So was I. Who clothed you? Your parents. If they were not there, whoever was nearby, they put something onto you in order to give you the honor, the respect, to distinguish you from the animal. Subhanallah. The animals, when they are born, what happens? No cow begins to take a piece of cloth and cover the other cow. It doesn't happen. But human beings, part of your dignity is to cover you. When you die, what happens? You are covered. Subhanallah. Again, you are covered. Both times by someone else, not you. That's a gift of Allah. Allah is showing you, oh man, you are here for a purpose. When you came with nothing, someone covered you. When you die with nothing, someone will cover you. You go, subhanallah. What happened in the middle? That was your test. That's your examination. When you entered the school, you knew nothing. In the school, you learned everything. Then you have your final examination and you have monthly tests and weekly tests that may contribute towards the final result. But when you graduate from the school, what happens? You just take the result. You take the result. That's it. At the school, they might talk about you. If you were an outstanding student, they might write your name on one of the boards out there to say in 1999, so-and-so was there. And that's what they will say. This man was a very brilliant student. But that is not really going to help you. It is not going to help you unless you have practiced upon what you've learned. I learned mathematics, and come the day of the examination, I know 1 + 1 = 2, but purposely I say, no, it's 3. And then I start laughing and say, that was just a joke. You failed already, because on the ground, you need to say the right thing. The same applies with Allah. We know what's right and wrong. When we were kids, we learned halal, haram. We learned so many things. As we grew older, we know what is halal, permissible, what will earn the anger of Allah, what is going to earn the wrath of Allah. We know it. But the sad reality is we intentionally sometimes go against it. I know that by me doing this act, I'm going to earn the displeasure of Allah, but I still do the act. Don't be foolish. My brothers and sisters, Allah loves us enough to say, if you seek forgiveness, I will still forgive you. Subhanallah. It reminds me of an examination paper. Whilst you are writing, and then you realize, hey, I did the wrong thing. I wrote the wrong thing. You can cross it off. You can ask for another paper. The invigilator will gladly provide you with another paper. You can write the correct answer for as long as you are inside the exam room. The minute you exited the room, too late. So when you die, it's too late. When you are alive, you can ask for another paper, clean paper, write the correct answer. Oh, you wrote it wrong the second time. Okay, delete it the second time. Write the correct answer the third time. Yes, that's the way Allah operates. He will give you chance upon chance, but you don't know when the bell is suddenly going to ring. You know, recently we've been having power cuts and you have a power surge. I was explaining death to one of the youngsters a few days ago and he was telling me, how does it feel like to die? I said, my son, I have not yet died. So I cannot explain to you how it will be except from the Quran and the Sunnah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when you believe and you've done good deeds, your death will be very easy. It's like turning off a switch. The only difference is, when you turn off a switch, you know you're turning it off. In this case, it's more like an MCB tripping. What happened? There was life and suddenly, boom, it's gone. No more life. What happened? It was not so painful. It was just, nothing actually was destroyed. The MCB tripped. And life came to an end. Electricity came to an end. That's the same that will happen to us. One day there will be a surge. What's the surge? Something happens. Either it's, and this is Allah's mercy, to be able to blame something. Either it's a heart attack, either it's a car crash, either it is something, either you get burnt. What happens? There is a surge. After that, the MCB trips. You're gone. Subhanallah. The appliances, everything remain in the house. The electricity is not there anymore. You are not there. You are gone. May Allah make it easy for us on that day. This was just a little example. But the primary duty unto Allah is to worship Allah alone. Worship Allah alone. Make sure you fulfill your duties unto Allah. It is called huququllah, the rights of Allah. When Allah tells you to do something, make sure you do it. When Allah tells you to abstain from something, make sure you abstain from it. So that you can earn the mercy of Allah. Keep on asking Him when you do a good deed. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ Oh Allah, accept it from us. I did the good deed. I read my salah. I read my Quran. I fasted. I gave my zakat. I went for hajj. I went for umrah. Oh Allah, accept it from me. The acceptance is more important than anything else. If you did it correctly, for the right reasons, with the correct intention, Allah will accept it. But ask Allah to accept it. So everything good you do, don't just feel good about it and say, right, that's me. I'm a big man. No, no. You need to ask Allah to accept it first of all. Ibrahim alayhi salam and his son Ismail alayhi salam were instructed to build the Kaaba by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When they completed it, the Quran Surah Al-Baqarah, this is where the verse comes. He says after he fulfilled the instruction of Allah to him to build the house, oh Allah, we've now built the house. Accept it from us. Subhanallah. For indeed you are all hearing. You are all knowing. So when you do a good deed, ask Allah to accept it. When you do something for Allah, ask Allah to accept it. And ask Allah to forgive your shortcomings. وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ Oh Allah, forgive us. You are indeed tawwab. What's the meaning of tawwab? Tawwab refers to two things. The term tawbah means two things. It means to return to Allah. And for Allah, it means to accept the forgiveness. So when you say ta'ib, one who turns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you say man taba, taballahu alayh. Whoever seeks the forgiveness of Allah, whoever returns to Allah, Allah will forgive him. The same word is used, taba and taba. So it means both things, depending on the context. When you use taba, referring to Allah, it means the acceptance of the tawbah. When you use taba, referring to human beings, it means to return to Allah in forgiveness, seeking forgiveness. So this is why we always say, oh Allah, forgive us. For indeed, you are the acceptor of forgiveness. You are the one who accepts forgiveness, not once. So many times. Allah says, Tawwab. Those who know the Arabic language, they know that there is emphasis. The wow is doubled. And there is an emphasis. It's called ta'kid in the Arabic language for a reason, to show you that it happens often. This is a reason. Subhanallah. So when Allah says Ta'ib, it means He forgives you once. That's not one of His names. It is At-Tawwab. Abdul Tawwab. The worshipper of the one who always forgives. Not just one time. Every time. So my brothers and sisters, don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seek His forgiveness. Worship Him alone. Always look at how shaitan is trying to trap you. Because shaitan's job is to trap. That's what shaitan's job is. So it's like a multiple choice. And I've said this before as well. Where you have a question. 1 plus 1. I said it last week if I'm not mistaken. 1 plus 1 equals A, 2. B, 3. C, 0. You got to choose A, B or C. Shaitan keeps on telling you A. It's C. It's C. And you know A. It is A, not B or C. It is A. I know, I learnt it. But shaitan convinces you, no, I'm telling you, there's a new technology out. It's no longer 2. It's something advanced. Just write 0. You get it right. Then you write 0. You fail. That's what shaitan does to us when it comes to sin. You know what's wrong. You know this is going to earn the displeasure of Allah. But shaitan says, hang on, don't worry. It's okay. You know, Allah is forgiving. Sometimes this is what shaitan does. Don't worry. One time, fine. It has a disastrous effect upon us, my brothers, my sisters. But I want to go on to the second set of duties that we have. The first one, the duties unto Allah. I spoke about the primary duty unto Allah, to worship Him alone without associating partners with Him. Allah alone deserves all acts of worship. So shaitan will come and try and make you render an act of worship to someone else, to something else. Be careful. Keep on asking yourself, am I involved in any way in shirk? In association of partners with Allah? Why do I need to keep on asking myself that question? Because that is the main thing that shaitan will trap you by. That is the main objective of your creation on earth, is to ensure that you worship Allah alone. Right at the beginning, Surah Al-Baqarah, the first instruction Allah gives man, Allah says, Ya ayyuhan nasu a'budu rabbakumu alladhi khalaqakum. Oh people, worship your Rabb who created you. Don't worship anything else, obviously. Worship your Rabb who created you. So once I've worshipped Allah and I make sure that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala definitely indeed is being worshipped alone, I need to realize there is another set of duties. What are those set of duties? I have fulfilled my duty unto my Maker. Now, my Maker has made other creatures besides me. The same Maker. If your father has other children besides you, what do they become? Your brothers, your sisters, right? How? Because they are linked to you via a parent. When Allah has created other creatures, He created them for a purpose. The purpose is to test you through the rest of the creatures that you will interact with throughout your little test. Subhanallah. So I fulfill my duty unto Allah as my Maker, and I have to fulfill my duty unto the rest of the creatures of the same Maker, because they were made by the same Allah. Today when we sit, we feel entitled. Every one of us thinks, I am me and it is I. That's what we think. Right now you're sitting, you are important to yourself. Very important to yourself. But you become a winner when you start thinking the man next to me is equally important. That's when you are a winner. Because then you start realizing that I'm not the only one here. My life on earth is very short. I come here and I will be known for something and I will leave. This is why the one who cheats, the one who deceives, the one who has bad deeds. The hadith says on the day of judgment, they will each have a flag. What is the flag? هَذِهِ غَدْرَةُ فُلَانِ بْنُ فُلَانِ. This person, what is this flag? This flag is the deception of that man, son of that man. Which means by name you are known for what you really achieved on earth. You were a big deceiver. So now on the day of judgment, you are known as the deceiver. You were a liar. So on the day of judgment, you are known as a liar. Subhanallah. Remember this. You know, it's easy for me and you to call each other liars. That means nothing. But what really means something, when Allah declares someone a liar, then the game is over. May Allah forgive us. إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَكْذِبُ حَتَّى يُكْتَبَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ كَذَّابًا. A person who lies begins to believe the lies and begins to forget the truth
in such a way that Allah declares his name as a liar. It's over. His brain shuts down to the truth. Complete shutdown. He doesn't know. It is closed and switched off. And he begins to believe in reality that Wallahi al-Azim, this thing is the truth, yet it is a lie. Why? Because the hadith says, when a man is satisfied with his falsehood, he is written by Allah, hatta yuktaba inda Allahi kadhaban. He's written in with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a liar. The door is closed. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. So on the day of judgment, the door is definitely closed, because people will have their flags. The question I have for myself and yourselves. Powerful question, serious question. And wallahi, it is no joke. We are now aging. We are becoming older and older, closer to our graves as the days pass. Wallahi, the question is, what would you like to be known as on the day of judgment? That's the question. I repeat the question. On the day of judgment, in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what do you want to be known as? Work towards that. Work towards it. If you work towards it, trust me, Allah will grant you that. But if you defy, and if you deny, and if your ego disallows you from turning back, then remember, it is none other than you to blame. فَلَا يَلُومَنَّ إِلَّا نَفْسَهُ. The hadith says, whoever sees anything besides goodness, they can only blame themselves. They can only blame themselves. So my brothers and sisters, you have a duty unto your brothers and sisters who are next to you, your brothers and sisters across the globe, the other creatures of Allah, the trees, the plants, the animals, the dogs, the pigs, everything. Allah made it for a purpose. Do you know, as Muslims, we know the regulations regarding pig, pork, bacon, whatever else. We know how we become very, very... What can I say? We become very protective over ourselves when there is association with, may Allah grant us all honor and dignity, association with a pig. So someone will say, no, pig, not at all. Please don't do this. And I won't associate myself. But remember one thing, as much as a pig is considered where it is considered in Islam, we are not allowed to suddenly just harm the pig as a result of that. You see a pig, you start throwing stones. No, that is haram. The pig has a liver. The pig has lungs. The pig has a soul. That soul was created by the same creator who created your soul. Have you thought of it that way? The answer is, oh. Well, it's the first time I'm looking at it that way. The dog out there that we throw stones at, na'udhu billah. May Allah protect us from doing that. It's wrong, because the same Allah, maker, who made you and me, wallahi, think about it, he made the dog. He gave the dog a soul. The dog was also born, just like you were born. The pig was also born, just like you were born. The test is encapsulated in a specific set of rules. And that is, you won't consume, you won't touch, etc., etc. Did Allah say, just go and do as you please, start throwing stones and harm and kill, let the thing cry? No way, no way, not at all. Even when you are, for example, getting rid of rodents or something that is a nuisance, you need to do it in the most respectful way, knowing, oh Allah, with your permission, I'm getting rid of this. When you are sacrificing, slaughtering an animal for consumption, to eat, you have a duty unto the cow. You have a duty unto the sheep. What is the duty? You need to use the most humane, the most simple, the quickest way of taking the life of that animal, because it has rights that you need to fulfill. Subhanallah, the animals. So this is why we say, we talk about huququllahi, we talk about huququl ibadi. We talk about the rights of Allah, the rights of the worshippers, the others who are around you. You don't deceive them, you don't cheat them, you don't steal from them, you don't lie about them, you honor them, you make sure that you protect them, you lend help, you lend assistance. You know, today, a lot of us are going through various struggles, because the situation, not only here, but across the globe, is a little bit tough. Do you know that if you cannot help someone, the biggest thing you can do, don't harm them. That is the biggest gift. There was a time when people used to say, oh, this guy is my friend. Why? Because you know he helps me. My brother, Allah is the one who gave you that. If yes, you respect them, you honor them, but you need to know the limits of that relationship too. You know, a man who is a murderer, you cannot support him simply because he helps you. No. You have to understand your duty unto the rest of the creatures of Allah. Stand up for justice for the sake of Allah. Not for the sake of a hand that feeds you. No. For the sake of Allah. Because if Allah wants, the tables will turn and they can turn. And what happens? You're stuck on the day of judgment with a flag saying a man who stood up for injustice solely because there was a hand that fed him. May Allah forgive us. May Allah grant us a lesson and an understanding. This is why we say, my brothers and sisters, there was a time when we used to say, this man is good, he helped me. Wallahi, the times have changed. This man is brilliant because he does not harm me. That's where we are today. And I consider my best friends those who have not harmed me. I don't need your help. I just need you not to harm me. Leave me alone. That's all. All of you would agree with the same thing I'm saying, because life has changed where people are looking how to harm this man. You see a person driving a beautiful vehicle. First thing, hey, this man must be doing drugs, man. Why say that? If you kept quiet, you are an honorable person. You are honorable. Leave him. Did he steal from you? The answer is no. Well, then do your thing. Subhanallah. Subhanallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a beautiful understanding. My time is up, my brothers and sisters, but this is a beautiful topic I thought of touching on to say we have two primary duties, that towards our Maker and that towards the rest of the creatures of the same Maker, starting with mankind. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. May Allah make us the best of people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the best of the dunya and the akhirah. May we become closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May love and unity spread in our community and in all other communities and the ummah at large. May we embrace one another with justice for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that will please Allah, such that our problems of the dunya and the akhirah are resolved simply by the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد.